Hello, I'm Jörg and I'll present. Oh, it goes very quick. I present here my work on Rudolf, and it started at the last OrConf 1 year ago, and it's about a RISC-V implementation. The motivation for it is that I want to do it a hard real-time core, because I came from academics and there we did a lot of research on this hard real-time cores, and at the moment many implementations of RISC-V are still capable to do a timing analysis, and that's important if you have a real hard real-time system, because in a real hard real-time systems you have deadlines and you have to do a static timing analysis, and to do this you have to predict everything what is inside the core, and if you have speculative components it would be difficult. Currently many RISC-V implementations are not very complicated, and there is not much or relatively simple branch predictions, for example, or simple caches. But I think this will increase, and then you again have a problem with the timing analysis. So this is my approach, is to stay at this predictable level and provide a core where you can do very easily, where it's very easy to do a timing analysis. That's the motivation for Rudolf. Because if you have this, if you have the speculative components, currently what is it, state of the art, there are papers published on it that you just turn them off. You turn off the cache, you turn off the branch prediction, even you turn off other cores because you have interactions between the cores that are not predictable. So I want to avoid this, and so Rudolf is built from scratch for predictability. Sorry. So it started 1 year ago at the OrConf 2018. There was the Soft CPU contest was announced, and this was for me. I always wanted to plan to build such a core, and then say, "Okay, that's now I can start to build my own core." I had some experience from the university because I was advisor for several lectures, and in this lecture we built VHDL models of a simple five-stage pipeline. And so I saw at least 50 implementations of the RISC-V pipeline, and I had to find bugs there, and so I had a lot of experience with that. And the goal of this lecture was to compile some simple programs with GCC and then run it on this pipeline. So this works. So this was my starting point. And then there was this soft CPU contest last year. The goal was more or less to have a very fast or a very small core. I tried to participate, but I didn't finish. It was very much work. The good thing about it was that you could, the target was Lattice, so you could use the free, the open source toolchain of iStorm, and I used it, and it was very easy to take it. But there were some hurdles that you had from this, from the contest. So one thing was you had to pass the compliance test. That's not so easy because you have these exceptions, and the exceptions just doing an exception and jumping to some other point in the memory, it's not the problem. The problem is that you have to save the state to the CSR registers, and this is pretty complicated. So this was more work to do there, but it's manageable in this. It was about two months where you had for this contest. The next hurdle was to build for the Sci-Fi OS application, because this has some requirements. At least it needs a timer interrupt, because you have to do this timer tick for the scheduler. So you have to implement this external timer interrupt. And it also requires multiplication and division. I experienced, because I'm not absolutely sure about it, but when I compiled my programs without the multiplication support, but then the program crashes, I think the reason is about that when you can, you have this timer interrupt and your timer tick, and you have this, you have to divide it to get your tick for the program and for 1 second. And you, there are a lot in the scheduler. There are a lot of multiplications and divisions. And so if you only use the emulation from GCC, it's too slow. So then your whole program doesn't work. So this was what I had to do for the last contest. I didn't get it. I just got the compliance test run. Cypher wasn't okay, so the last contest was not so, I was not so good at it. But now came the second. It was announced in the mid of June, or not July. And there it was a different scope. You had to thwart some security attacks. And I thought this would be very interesting, also in the context that I want this predictable course, so this all safety, security, and some niche. I think it was very interesting and would fit. So I started to do this. And because I entered this contest, I have to excuse me now, because when I asked for this talk here, it was before I noticed this contest, and therefore I couldn't do what I actually wanted to do and wanted to present here. I wanted to present here that my core is not just simple, it's just predictable, and you have an increased performance to very simple five-stage pipelines. Sorry, I couldn't do that. So I have to present this maybe in by the next OrgConf. So what I've actually will present is what I did for this soft CPU contest and how I want to improve performance. It's just future work on my last slide. So, only short on this architecture, it's nothing special about it. It's just a five-stage pipeline. I'm not using any cache, so you just have the zero latency sketchpad memory. It's for embedded systems, so this is okay, and it was also for this contest, it was always this what was required. And nothing special about the, so here's the instruction timing, what is important for such a predictable core, nothing special about it. Arithmetics in one cycle, because you have full forwarding. Even a barrel shifter, that's no problem from the size, it's not so difficult if you have an FPGA target. Maybe the one thing that's about predictability is that you have this branch latency. So for a not taken branch, you just continue your execution. And if you have a taken branch, you just kill the last two instructions because they are still in the pipeline and then continue with the next fetching. It's also very simple, but it's on the critical path. And this is what I want to say. This is maybe this would the first, if you want to improve performance, this would be the first point where you attack, because this is critical, but then your latency becomes bigger and then you have to do a branch prediction. But I think with only two cycles, a branch prediction is not so important. Yes, so I come to this soft CPU contest that just ended last week. What was the what you had to do is there was a program given, RIPE, the Runtime Intrusion Prevention Evaluator. It is used to simulate security attacks. I didn't know about that, it was completely new for me. It just, so I'm not a specialist in this, so if I say something wrong, you can interrupt me. It just simulates when what you can do with buffer overflows, as far as I understand. So you, the attack is mainly you override something in memory, either a pointer, so that you jump in your program execution to another code of the part of the code where you can start your attack, or that you directly override some code and or jump to a location where there are instructions and then you execute these instructions and do something nasty. This is on this program, and in this program it's a lot of here are the parameters that you can Phil, I won't read out everything, but it's very interesting what you can do. So I do not completely understand what they all can do, but what you can see here, for example, you can these code pointers as where you can modify the return address on the stack, also some function pointers on the heap or the stack. The location is also important, so you can have the stack or the heap or something else, and you can use different functions to override this memory. So functions that you can use for an attack. And in the contest, there was the question, you should, there were five specific attacks were defined, and you should find a hardware solution against that. So it's very interesting. I didn't know about that you could do this, and thinking a little bit about it, but there are some solutions how you could do something against this attacks. So for hardware design, say, okay, it's a software problem. They have to, maybe they have to do some form of verification, and then they have no problem on their software. But we do a hardware thing, and my idea was, when I looked at these attacks, they all had the same, they had one common thing. For the function they used, they took a function called homebrew memcopy. It's simple, a memcopy, but it's done byte by byte. And there was a point where I can recognize if there is an attack. I simply wanted to see if a memory location is overwritten byte by byte, then I say, oh, there is something nasty, and I have to throw an exception there. That was my idea. And I implemented it. This was done. I have in the memory. I added one bit to every word in the memory. It's not so difficult on the FPGA because the FPGA very often have parity bits added. So the memory is not 9, not 8 bytes. A byte is not 8 bytes, but you have mostly 9 bits per byte, or you have 36 bits instead of 32 bits, so it costs you nearly nothing. And so I used one of these bits for every word. I called it the grubby bit. And this grubby bit is set when you do a byte store to a location or a half word store to a memory location. And if you do a complete word write, you clear the bit. Very simple and not much logic needed for it. And then when I fetch the instructions, I check if this bit is set. If it's set, I throw an exception that this instruction is, there's some problem with this instruction. And with this I could detect two attacks, but I needed something more. And the other attacks, their memory location was overwritten and used as a pointer, or as one was that you have the return address of your, so you modify on the stack the return address, and it was overwritten. So to detect them, that I had to modify the pipeline a bit so that you, when you have a load, you load also this grubby bit, and then you put. Then you have to store it in the register set, because when you do a jump, you have this the next instruction. So when you have a jump and link instruction in RISC-V, then you have to check if in this register word that you need, if there is the grubby bit set. So then this is another exception. And I tried it, and it works. So I don't have false positives. This was my biggest anger. That I may have false positives, but the code that GCC and also the Cypher produces, there are no bytewise writes to locations where you should have pointers. So that's no problem, and if you write correct code, I think it shouldn't also be a problem. So false positives shouldn't be a problem for this solution. What is a problem? I cannot detect if an attacker really managed to write 32 bits at once. I cannot detect it. That's clear. There you need another solution. But I think it's not that bad because it's very small. This solution, if you have this additional bit, this is maybe if you have a large memory, this would be a problem. But maybe you can find other solutions that you have one bit per cache line or things like that. So the overhead is very slow, and it can be useful if you want to protect string functions. So if I think that you, when you use your in your glib or whatever you use in your program, that you use implementations of the string functions that only use byte stores, you're on a safe side, because then these functions cannot be used as for an attack, because if you have this byte rise, you can detect them by hardware. So maybe this would be a use case where you can use this technique to at least reduce the space where attacks can be done. Only memcopy remains. That's, you cannot avoid it because it would be too slow, or maybe if under certain conditions, maybe you can also implement it by bytes. So what are the insights from my development? I think this is the most interesting point. What I think that for such a small design, I started to use memory mapped peripherals even for the first context, but it makes it very slow because the memory accesses on the critical path. Though I then used CSRs instead because they are not so critical to increase the clock frequency. Another thing that I discovered is this Drystone is not a good benchmark, because yes, I added the support for multiplications with 34 cycles, and then when I compile it, then in the code there's only one multiplication in Drystone. It multiplies with 200. And when I used this new, it took 35 plus 1, so 35 cycles. But when GCC optimizes it, that if he knows you don't have a multiplier, it only takes 5 cycles. So my benchmark numbers for Drystone are slower. I have a multiplier, but the Drystone store is smaller. What I also learned is that exceptions are really, if you have such a small design, these exceptions are really costly. And I'm trying to, what will be one of the next thing is that I will add the support for 16-bit instructions, so the RV32C, and unaligned memory accesses, because with these two, I get rid of two exceptions. And I think the hardware, the logic cost will be about the same size, but it will be more efficient. And what I also learned there for the next applause, iStorm is very easy to use and much better and faster than the proprietary tools that I had to use there. So this was also an experience. So this is my last slide. This is what I originally wanted to talk to talk about. I just bring some what I have to do. I have to increase the quality. This is not so interesting. I want to do a formal verification. I even wanted to do before I came here, but now I'm really into it. I think this is really important. And I want to increase the performance. I think what you can do is, again, increase the multiplication. Also, what you can do is to do a call return stack, so this, and some prefetching, and maybe you can do then at least unconditional jumps at zero cycles, so you can avoid them before. And I think this should be improve the performance in loops at least. And dual issue would be the idea. I think you can do this in a very predictable manner. That puts, and instruction fusion, it's also in the RISC-V specification, it's often mentioned, this instruction fusion. I think this is also a good idea to improve in the performance in a predictable way. Thank you for your attention.
Hey, just wanted to comment that while I completely agree Drystone is a terrible benchmark, it turns out that the GCC cost model actually does understand this issue, and if you adjust the cost model to reflect the latency of multiply, then it will do the right thing with shift and adds in that case.
Yeah, I think there's this mTune, I thought, and there is some work, it's just not yet working. I think it's also very important we have so many RISC-V implementations and we need this such that we can do something about it.
Okay. So you said your initial goal was to have a fixed and predictable timing through the CPU. Did I catch that right?
Yeah. Yes. It's still.
How do you deal with SDRAMs? The SDRAM is going to have its own refresh cycle.
There are solutions not for DDR3 RAM, but there are other things like there are some projects. It's called. Sorry, I can look after it. There are some works on to have such predictable SDRAMs. They exist. They are not very fast. They are slow, but there are solutions. Maybe mostly it's that you have some isolation and you have only slots, so you do time division multiplexing more or less to get this, and you have maximum times.
Okay, so let me move on. I have one other comment or question. I had to deal with the C library. Have you looked into how the C library actually implements the string calls, or are you not using a standard C library?
It depends on what you do it. What I used here was the standard for sci-fi, and I think it's NewLib.
So NewLib, I've noticed several of the copies use word level interactions rather than just
memcopy and so on, but not the string. You're correct. Yeah, they use it. But not in these programs that I tested, so they didn't appear there. It was for the contest. But I think it would be an idea to implement it in this way, to have, if you want to build a system for security.
So that was going to be my last question, was did you notice any performance difference between the word level and the byte level? And it sounds like you were using byte level both ways, so you didn't really see any opportunity for difference.
I think it's not very important. It's not a critical part thing.
Okay.
Only if you have long strings, but I think not in the embedded space.
So let's thank the speaker.
Thank you.